Italian international fullback Umberto Calligaris held the record for most international caps with 59 at the time of his untimely death in 1940. The Juventus coach and former player for the Old Lady Club was only 39 when he passed away. And in the 1950s, a lasting memorial to the defender originated in his birthplace, the northern Italian town of Casal Monferrato. Juniores di Calcia Calligaris was the under-21 international youth tournament, dubbed by the Daily Record as the Junior European Cup, that Celtic were invited to compete in as the reigning European champions in 1968. Tournament joint favourites Celtic and Inter Milan were separated into two sections of the 8-team tournament, with Celtic grouped alongside Juventus, Sparta Prague and local town sides and hosts AS Casale Calcio. By the time the youth team, who were then referred to as the Celtic Colts, flew out from Glasgow Airport on Friday, May 31st, 1968, Celtic had lost their coveted European crown to Manchester United, but this did not dampen the spirits of the 19-man squad, who travelled with tour manager Sean Fallon and trainer Bob Rooney. Jockstein again showed his media prowess by generating a buzz amongst the Scottish hacks for this youth tournament. By the time the Celtic youngsters were suited up and ready to go, the press were waiting outside Celtic Park and at the airport to get photographs. Most, if not all, of the faces on display were unknown, but within a few years, many of them would be the hottest properties in Scottish football. Jimmy Quinn and Davy Catenach were left behind due to Celtic being misinformed that it was an under-19 tournament, while others like Vic Davidson and Kenny Dalglish were too young to expect to be playing. But this crop of youngsters were the earliest sign that something special was developing at the club. The players selected from Celtic's impressive youthful cornucopia were goalkeepers Bobby Wraith and Tommy Livingston, vice-captain John Murray, Danny McGrain, John Gorman, Fred Pettard, Irish trialist Jackie Clark, captain George Connolly, Billy Murdoch, Paul Wilson, Davy Hay, Kenny Dalglish, Tony McBride, Pat McMahon, Johnny Hempel, Lou Macari, Hugh McKellar, Jim Clark and Victor Davidson. From that group, 12 would go on to play for Celtic's first team, with Hay and Connolly appearing in a European Cup final within 2 years. Three of them would manage the club, and half a dozen of the Celtic Colts would later gain full international honours, amassing 218 Scottish caps between them. I am speaking, of course, about the Quality Street Gang. A photograph of that young Celtic team appeared in the 1968 summer edition of the Celtic View, and it was that photo that worked as a blueprint for me when I decided to tell the remarkable story of the Quality Street Kids. One of their charges, Paul Wilson, sadly passed away this week at the age of 66, and I was lucky enough to have interviewed Paul when I was writing the book. I dug out some of my old interview tapes for this podcast, which will be split into two parts, as I feel that it's an appropriate time to bring their story back to life. Some of the names here are known throughout world football, whilst others may have been lost to the depths of time. I'll let the players do the talking. First up, Bobby Murdoch's younger brother, Billy. Billy, one of the most interesting things that you and I discussed a wee while back was the fact that you and your two brothers were all at Celtic Park at the same time. Could you describe how that happened and how, you know, football and Celtic run in your family?
Well, our family were from Bridgeton, you know, and we were all Celtic supporters, and my dad, obviously, and he used to take us to the games, but he maybe could only take one at a time, you know, when we were wee, but we eventually, Jockstein came in to sign Bobby when he was 15, and, he signed, and then I played with Drumchapel Amateurs, and they asked me to go and train. Then James, my other brother, he was with Jim Chappell, which is a smaller team, and he ended up playing in the same team, and he got asked to train at Parkhead, but he eventually went to Cardiff City, so they were kind of spread out. And when I went to Bristol after I left Celtic, he was at Cardiff and we played. Bristol's just across the bridge, Cardiff, so we ended up playing against each other then as well. So we were kind of here, there and everywhere, sort of thing.
When you talk about playing for sides before Celtic came in, there was a memory we discussed when you played on this very pitch and you came up against the young Danny McGrain.
That's right.
You tell me your memories of that and your memories of Danny that day?
Well, memories of Danny that day, he played at left half. I mean, he was a... Well, you know how good a right back he ended up He played at left half, but it was still top notch then, you know. So I think we drew 2-2 or something, but after that we got to playing against each other regularly in the amateur league, and then both of us ended up at Parkhead, you know, so we've got been quite friendly with Danny.
You mentioned ending up at Celtic Park. Billy, could you tell us your memories of Celtic scouting and identifying you, and eventually how you signed and went up to the park, your early memories of that?
Well, no, really. I played for Drumchapel Amateurs, who were probably one of the top amateur teams, and there, the man that ran them, Dougie Smith, he's a well-known figurehead in amateur football, and he kind of recommended me to Celtic, and he said, I'll get you to train up there, and that's really how it was, more or less him that asked me if I could go and train, you know. But as I say, that's the only memory I can remember, that how it happened, sort of thing.
Going up to Celtic Park, and there was this tradition of going up maybe on a Tuesday and a Thursday.
That's correct, aye.
European champions, and obviously your big brother was the star man in that team. Who can you remember amongst the young boys that you played alongside when you first went up? Who stood out for you as players?
Oh, well, the obvious ones, it was Vic, Davidson, Kenny, Danny, Paul Wilson, George Connolly, and Davey Hay. Davey Hay was actually, he was the same as me, he was part-time. That's one thing I regret, was I know you've got to have a trade behind you, and that kind of held me back, because I wasn't really getting a game as regular as the rest of them. But I remember Davey Hay and Jim Brogan were the two kind of still part-time sort of thing. But there was some, like I said, there was Danny, he was part-time as well, but they all ended up, well, you know how they ended up. Top notch.
Not too long after you went up to Celtic Park, Billy Jogstein had organised a youth tournament over in Italy.
That's right.
And it was called the Youth European Cup.
Yeah.
Now, there's some fantastic pictures of all the boys with the blazers. Can you remember getting fitted up and the excitement?
I've still got that blazer, believe it or not. And it's the badge. I peeled the badge off, but the badge is still in the pocket sort of thing, you know. But I remember we all went into the town, and as I say, but there must have been 20 of us, you know. They didn't really know who was going on the trip, sort of thing, you know. But we were, it was kind of, when you walked down the street with a blazer on, you weren't really hip, as they say. We used to run down the back streets of Rutherglen, so they would see the blazers. But that's just the times it was then.
Once you finally got over to Italy and you're representing Celtic, you've said to me previously that you were maybe a wee bit overall with some of the boys that were there. What's your memories of the trip, the games and the pitches and your general memories of that trip?
The heat was terrible, you know, and at half time you were sweating and that, and you'd go, oh, I'm glad to get in and get a drink of water, as you thought. It was lemon tea roasting, but it was amazing how it did cool you that time. We were looking for something refreshing sort of thing, but it was lemon tea, but the parts were solid, you know. It was, and they seemed more muscular than us, the Italians, you know. They just seemed a bit fitter than us, you know. Maybe it was the time of the year sort of thing. But
I think there was actually a mistake, Billy, in that the Celtic thought it was an under-18 tournament. It was an under-21 tournament. And all you guys were a lot younger than me.
Aye, well, that's as I say, they all looked kind of, you know, a wee bit stronger and, well, no more professional, but just seemed to know each other better. I mean, our team was just put together inside a 3 or 4 weeks sort of thing, you know. It's kind of a mixture of part time and full time. I don't think we done very well, actually. Seemed to see Kenny and Vic Davidson and that, they were in that pool of players, but I mean, look how good they were, and they didn't even play sort of thing, you know. So that's how young we were, sort of thing. We weren't, I don't think we were really ready at the time.
Yeah, I think Kenny and that were maybe a year or two younger than the likes of Davey, etc.
When
you look at that, obviously Sean Fallon and Bob Rooney went over to Italy with you. What was the backroom setup that Steen had, and who assisted the reserve in the third team that you had at
That was the time they were kind of doing away with the third team, but it was mostly Sean that helped us. I mean, he done everything, you know, he was some man, so he was, and he had a happy knack of telling you how you were in the plane that day. He used to say, we'd go to the pre-match meal in the hotel, and then when we were finished, we'd be going on the bus, and Sean would say to you, or say to me anyway, have you got your coat with you? In other words, you'll be sitting in the stand, you know. So you knew when you were on the plane, and that was Sean, but a great man sitting
there. When you think back to the training as well, Billy, how tough was that? Not only training with the great team that you were part of, mm-hmm. but the excellent senior team as well. How tough was it? Can you remember any?
I don't think it was that. Once you had a tough 2 weeks, you know, you usually started training at the Glasgow Fair, and you had a really tough 2 weeks, but after that it wasn't bad, you know, because you had to run, most days you were running up and down to Barrowfield, you know, that was a way along London Road sort of thing. But no, it was, once you were fit, it was a okay sort of thing, you know.
When you look at the first team, the Lisbon Lions, Billy, how were they able to help the young players? Did you ever see them assisting and giving a wee bit of advice? How were they able to help you?
Aye, sometimes you were, when you pull out a couple of the boys and let them train with them sort of thing, you know, but actually they were all, you know how good they were, and we just kind of learned from them sort of thing. It wasn't a case of they kind of come over and taught you, but if they were maybe dropped in early, maybe they were injured and they were trying to back the reserves to get in the first team again, they would help you, you know, but they were all, I mean, when you looked at them, you said, oh, what am I doing here? When am I ever going to get a game, you know? But that's a real way.
I think also you and I have discussed some of the boys that were up at Celtic Park who never ever signed for the club.
That's right.
It may surprise some people. Could you run through that for us as well?
Well, some of the boys, I can remember their names, but I don't know, you know, that they ever made it elsewhere. Very, very. When I think it, very few of them made it elsewhere, you know, but there was that many coming through. They were here, they were just like a mill sort of thing, you know, they were just churning them out, and some of them didn't last very long, you know. I was part-time for a long time because I had a trade, I was serving my trade, you know, but as I said to you before, I think that kind of held me back sort of thing.
Yes, Davey says that was a turning point for him when he
went full time, and
you've mentioned players like Jim Holton who went on to Man United, Graham Souness, who we all know had a great career. Can you tell us what your memories are of these boys up at Celtic Park?
Well, Graham Souness, to be quite honest, I think he was only there two nights. He was signing for Spurs on the Wednesday, and I think Celtic had him up on the Tuesday night trying to change his mind sort of thing, but he was just out in the training ground himself, just kicking the ball up and doing. I think he was just waiting to see if they would sign or no, you know. But big Jim Holton, well, he used to come in, it was black as 2 a.m, and be straight for work, and he would be grabbed somebody, and you know the size of man he was, but he was a great fella, you know. Just sad what happened.
I think one of the big surprises for a lot of people now is that Jockstein tried to put the reserve team in 1960 actually into the second division.
Guys.
What's your memories of that? How well do you think the team would have done, Billy?
Oh, well, I think they would have done great, because we used to play friendlies against, I remember one game we played Morton, and it was Morton's first team, Joe Harper and all them, and it was down at Morton and we beat them 5-4, you know, so I think they were quite well equipped to hold their own anyway, you know.
You've already said that you've sometimes looked at that team and thought to yourself, how on earth am I going to get into that first team?
But yes.
Can you describe to me how more difficult it made it where you were wearing the number 4 shorts for the reserve team and your big brother's wearing them for the Lions? How tough was that for you?
Well, as I say, I never even, while they were, the Lions were there and they were doing it, I never even considered getting in the first team. You always, want to just take it regular with the reserves and then see how it goes. To be quite honest, when I left Celtic, I asked to leave Celtic, and I had to ask Bobby again and ask Joe Steen to let me, because I was quite still young then, and you just didn't. Because I was used to playing maybe every week, and then when a Celtic called you up, you were getting a game every 2 or 3 weeks, and just didn't. So I ended up asking to go away, as I say, and Bobby together and asked Joe. She said, all right then. I don't think it's a hard decision right now.
When you look at what happened to players like Lou Macari and Kenny Dalglish, I mean, you knew them as young mm-hmm. men. You know, did you notice their potential at that stage?
Oh, aye.
And how do you feel that they developed as players?
Oh, well, yeah, I must admit, Louis was, I mean, for quite a small guy, he was fast, he was great in the air. You could see potential, you know. And Davey was part-time like me. You could see how, as you said yourself earlier, that was a turning point in his career when he went full-time. And it was the same with Jim Brogan. Jim Brogan wasn't a regular, and then eventually when he went full-time, he became quite regular, you know. But as I say, most players, it was up there. You knew they were a good player. You know, they weren't there for nothing, sort of thing. And you had a job in your hands if you were wanting to stay there, get in the team.
Absolutely. I mean, only a couple of years after the Italian tournament, it's incredible to note that Celtic were in another European final in 1970, and both Davy and George played in the final. George coming on as a sub. We lost George through his own choice, but Davy, Lou, and Kenny were eventually sold for big money really down south. You played with all these guys. If Celtic had kept them together for as long, say, as the Lisbon Lions had been kept together, what do you think they might have achieved?
Oh, I think they could have done. Could have been the same as the Lisbon Lions with a mixture, you know, maybe one or two of the Lions still playing and them coming through, and some of the other boys that come through, Paul Wilson, Vic Davis, and obviously Danny, and then, you know, I mean, they just, as I say, they just churned them out, sort of thing.
And finally, when you think back also to when you finally left Celtic Park yourself, Billy, what's your memories of that? And now when you look back, you know, do you look back fond on your time up at Celtic Park?
I definitely jumped the gun when I left, sort of thing. As I say, I was used to playing, and then you were only getting a game once every 2-3 weeks, sort of thing, and it didn't do yourself any good. So I ended up going to Bristol and then come back up to Stenhousemuir, where I got a game every week, and eventually I come back when I was playing against Kenny and all them, you know, for Kilmarnock, sort of thing. So I could have taken a long way round to get back into the championship, sort of thing, you know. But okay, I jumped the gun, but you're a bit younger, you know, really, not really thinking, like, because you don't realise till you knew, or when you were older, what a team you were playing for, sort of thing, you know. It's up to you to knuckle down and try and do your best, but that wasn't the me, as I say.
Billy Murdoch had to live in the constant shadow of his legendary elder brother at Celtic, and he eventually moved on to Bristol City in 1970 without breaking into the first team. Murdoch was immediately homesick, and after a week of staying in a hotel, he travelled home only to be persuaded to return to Bristol for the rest of the season. He had worked for David Catanach and Alex Smith's glazing firm over the years, and when Smith heard that he was on a free transfer, he fought off competition from junior side Johnstonborough to win his signature for Stenhousemuir. After 6 enjoyable years at Oakleview, Murdoch's old Celtic trainer Willie Fernie signed him up for Kilmarnock, where he played alongside Gordon Smith, Jim Stewart and Davy Proven. 4 years later, he returned to play for a season at Stenhousemuir before finishing his career back in the junior ranks. Billy is still a season ticket holder at Celtic Park. From one player who didn't make the grade to one who certainly did, Lou Macari. Lou had already made his first team debut by the time he travelled to the birthplace of his ancestors.
100% certain when everyone sort of came together. But before I actually joined Celtic, and I think it would be the same for everybody, you had to go to Celtic, you were invited up to Celtic Park 2 nights a week for probably about 18 months, Tuesday and a Thursday night. And you trained, and you obviously, they kept an eye on you. Sean Farland was there, manager was always there, Jock Steen, and of course it was at a time when Lisbon Lions were there, and a good time to be, I was going to say part of Celtic, but you weren't part of Celtic. You were, I think that was one thing they made sure of, that at no time did you get carried away and actually believe you were on the you know, the verge of joining Celtic Football Club, or probably even in any way connected, because I don't think they believed that was the right way to go about it. And I've got to say, in this day and age, when I see everybody, all the kids everywhere, all over the country, attached to football clubs and academies, and actually believing that they're on the step to, you know, the first step to stardom, I've got to say that, looking back now, the way that Celtic and the way it was at the time was the right way. Yeah. All it was, you're invited up to train. Yeah, it was Celtic Park. You walked through the doors of Celtic Park, but it was to train and no more than that. No time did you ever consider, well, I didn't anyway, that I was going to be a Celtic Football Club. Well, I used to travel from Largs, where I lived, mm-hmm. on the supporters bus every week,
right.
To watch them. And at that time, you know, they weren't doing very well. Obviously, hundreds of thousands who started following Celtic at a bad time.
Yeah.
And then along came Jock Steen, and it all sort of changed. But I still remember one of the, I'm not 100% certain who it was against, but Jock's first trophy was at Hampden Park, and I was there.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that I'd not seen Celtic win anything, and I can't remember the score at the time, but we were leading, and I had to leave and sort of go up the steps of Hampden as always, going out the ground and sort of face the other way, because I couldn't believe we were actually going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'd never seen them win anything.
Wow.
And this was, I think, my Scottish Cup final.
Yeah.
And like all Celtic supporters, you were just praying that, and especially when you're young, you're praying that it's going to happen. And when that final whistle went, little did I know, just the start of bigger and better things to come. And of course that was the case. And you know, they're going to be winning. And then the next thing is, you know, they win a European Cup. European Cup, obviously, it's the birth of the Lisbon Lions.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure, you know, a couple of years later, I'm actually, you know, walking through the Celtic Park, mm-hmm. with the ground staff, as it was at the time, to look after these same Lisbon Lions. Don't know anything about them, except, obviously, what I've seen from the terrace and every week. And but now, all of a sudden, and it hits you so quickly,
mm-hmm.
all of a sudden, you're on the inside, you're part of Celtic Football Club, and just don't believe it, you're part of Celtic Football Club. To go on a trip,
mm-hmm.
abroad, whether it was Malta or Italy, it's just unbelievable.
Yeah.
To get a blazer. I've still got the blazer.
I've
still got the blazer upstairs.
Brilliant.
To get a blazer, just, you know, and I've, you know, people have said to me, "Do you get any souvenirs, Celtic souvenirs and all that?" And I've given away a lot, but I wouldn't give away the blazer. It's something that reminds me of, you know, coming through as a kid. And mm-hmm. of course, attached to that is, you know, the help you've had from your parents.
Yeah. Yep.
And my parents, who unfortunately didn't live that long after I sort of, you know, after I sort of made it.
Mm-hmm.
My mother lived another 10 years, but my father died probably three years after I'd sort of, 2 or 3 years after I broke into the team.
Right.
A couple of years watching me with Celtic, but you know, for me it wasn't long enough. And,
mm-hmm.
and my father and my mother would take me everywhere. You know, as a kid, if you were playing somewhere, they'd take me there. And of course you dreamt of a possible payback time, when if you made it one day, you could pay them back and look after them. But I never really got that opportunity, certainly with my father.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, it was due to a number of people that you actually went from a supporter to a player, and that included your mother and father, obviously included Sean
yeah.
Farland, who looked after me as a kid, and Jock Steen, who gave me advice and guided me in a certain way, and I've got to say, without those people behind me, I would never have been a player. I wouldn't. I believe it's a fine line between a youngster making it and not making it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was fortunate enough that somebody said, you know, they said to me, you need to get stronger, you need to get quicker,
yeah,
you need to do a lot of training, you need to do a lot of work, because you're small, you're not very strong. And taking their advice and them actually making me do it, putting me through it,
mm-hmm.
Is why I became a player. If I hadn't had those people looking after me, I really believe it faded away, because I remember Scotland schoolboys against England one day at Southampton,
mm-hmm.
and the pitch was heavy, like Southampton always was. The Dell it was, and the Dell at the time was notorious for a bit of rain, and it became a bit of a bog.
Right.
And the England boys were, you know, under-18s this was, the England boys were big, Mick Mills, Mick Shannon, people like that, they were big, they were, you know, they were 10, 11.
Mm-hmm.
I never got a kick, I took the mud. I never got a kick. Anybody watching me that day would have said, well, that little kid out there is never going to, never.
Right.
But as I say, I got that guidance from them. And, you know, fortunately, I got stronger and quicker, and, you know, by the time I was heading for England,
mm-hmm.
which is obviously where you need to be strong, I had no problem. When I started playing for Man United, I had no problem strength-wise.
Mm-hmm.
I had no problem with pace. I had no problem with any of those things, because I'd had the right upbringing with my parents, but even more so with the people at Celtic Park. People won't believe it, but Celtic Park was playing side of it was run by Willie Fernie, Neil Morgan, Sean Fallon, Jock Stein, Bob Rooney the physio.
Yes.
And Jimmy Steele.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy Steele the masseur.
Yeah, yeah.
There was six people. Well, I mean, there was lots of scouts and there was lots of other people on the fringes.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to be missing anybody out. But those six people more or less ran the place.
Right.
And those six people guided myself, Kenny Dalglish, Danny McGrain, David Hay, all onto careers,
mm-hmm.
and you know, fortunately for us all, good careers. There was lots. I can honestly say, and it's not having a go at the modern day player, there was lots of players who didn't make it,
mm-hmm.
who would walk into any club nowadays, because the competition for those number of places that were up for grabs for a youngster to join the ground staff.
Yeah.
Competition was fierce. Competition was so fierce that over those years, lots of players came out of Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of players eventually went to England. Lots of players made the big time, both in Scotland and in England. Lots of players lots of youngsters played for their country eventually.
Yes.
Doesn't happen nowadays.
No, no.
So there was lots of exceptionally good players became, well, casualties and fell by the wayside.
Yes.
Simply because of those numbers that were taken, these others had to be,
mm-hmm.
Left behind.
Mm-hmm.
But they wouldn't be left behind nowadays. You know, if you speak to school teachers and
mm-hmm.
ask them, you know, in the school team, have they got many possibilities? And I don't know the reason why, so I can't answer why. But if you ask most of them,
mm-hmm.
is there any prospects there of making it, and, you know, making the grade big time? The majority will probably say, well, I don't think so, but maybe one.
Yes.
But at that time, you know, to get four, that
it's incredible.
Moved on,
mm-hmm.
was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I think it goes back to what I said, that there was lots of potential players around and lots of players in contention to be taken up by football clubs. But then I just forgot about Gorry, who
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
obviously, you know, throughout my career when I moved south, he was down here all the time, and again, forget about a footballer, but as a person, and
yeah.
I don't know if you've met him, he's an absolute gem of a mm-hmm. person, and a proper human being, and a proper person.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know him and people like, you know, Sean Fallon and unfortunately who just passed away.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
all these guys were all good guys, and there's not, I hate to say it, there's not enough good guys around nowadays.
Absolutely, yeah.
John Gorman was another one who was so appreciative of being part of Celtic. He was mm-hmm. so conscientious, so focused, down to dedication.
Mm-hmm.
He'd have been top of the pile.
Yeah, yeah.
John ate, slept and drank football, and you know that carried on
mm-hmm.
right throughout his career. And I'd be surprised if any of the young street gang you're talking about, I'd be surprised when you're speaking to them if they didn't more or less all sort of say the same sort of thing, that
mm-hmm.
we really, looking back now, owe our careers down to the people who guided us. We were lucky we were part of the Celtic Football Club at a great time.
Mm-hmm.
There was a great manager there, great staff underneath him. And, the biggest thing of all, when you look back now, was your upbringing was tough because the manager, and, you know, it didn't go down too well at times. The manager demanded everything from you.
Yes.
He demanded, she became a player. I think it was fair to say you were, you know, barely allowed to breathe. He was on top of you
mm-hmm.
24 hours a day. He knew all your moves. If you were away with the team, he would demand you went to your bed at a certain time.
Yeah.
He demanded when you got up. He demanded what you ate able.
Mm-hmm.
Demanded that you weren't even 10 seconds late for training. And all these things, we're looking back, they were all fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. It doesn't happen nowadays. It's a shame because everything we're doing nowadays is wrong.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All the ideas everyone's got are wrong. Going back to Jock's time, the ideas were simple.
Yes.
And I know for a fact that when, you know, for example, when I took over as manager for that short period, I tried to get back to the ways of, simple ways of Jock.
Yeah.
One of them being, we ran to Barrowfield every day. Didn't want to know. It wasn't for them. They couldn't be seen running through the streets of Glasgow. Back, I thought, no, they didn't like it. It seemed as though to run through the streets of East End of Glasgow was, it just wasn't to happen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I found that hard to take, and that's what we did do. We ran down, we ran back,
mm-hmm.
and in between it, we trained so hard. Harder than the modern day player trains. He couldn't have trained the way we trained.
Right, right.
And I've got to knock that for six. I'm not even going to compare the Lisbon Lions, myself, or any of the team after it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to make any comparison between them and the modern day player in terms of ability. I'm not going to go down that road. I've got my own thoughts on it.
Yeah,
I'm not going to go down that road. But in terms of levels of fitness, we blow all of this modern day, all the modern day players away. We blow them away. The, you know, fitness levels were, if you missed the target, you know, a shooting practice.
Yeah.
With Jock, you had to go and collect your ball that might have, you know, might have ran away down a hill. It might have gone right over the top of the crossbar into the hospital next door.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that hospital's still there, but it used to be a hospital next door to Barrowfield.
Right.
And you go out the ground and run round and pick up your ball and come back. And if you didn't do it quickly, he'd be shouting at you, where have you been? And at the end of a hard day's training session every day, that sometimes lasted twice a day, because if anybody wasn't pulling their weight,
mm-hmm.
he would just blow his whistle and shout, right, everybody back to Celtic Park. See you all at 2 o'clock this afternoon, and you can thank so-and-so for it. And, you know, when you were jogging back to Celtic Park, moaning and groaning as you would be, he used to come along, because he went down in the car, he used to come along the car and wind the window down and shout, get a move on, you lazy lot. It was non-stop.
Mm-hmm.
It was, and I've got to say, looking back at the example that the Lisbon Lions set,
yeah.
You know, when you first get into the team, you're carrying the bags,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're carrying the skips into the ground, you're cleaning the boots, you're taken down to C Mill for a bit of a, you know, only to look after things. You know,
mm-hmm.
you're not in the squad or anything, but that's the start of you that's the start of you sort of getting close to the squad.
Yes.
You know, and when you do that, you're watching, at least I was watching them training unbelievably hard in the morning, just after their lunch.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them getting up in the afternoon, like wee Jimmy and Bobby Lennox, and going out and doing some extra training. And, you know, I'm watching this and thinking, bloody hell. So you know, when you start to get in the swing of things with them, you do it, and, you know, that extra training pays off. And unlike nowadays, when probably they do as little training as possible, the training then was, well, it was intense. You know, you had to do it, you had to do it properly, and if you didn't, it was so blue, and he would shout with a few swear words. You know, he would shout, right, every fucker back to Celtic Park, see you this afternoon at 2 o'clock. About it, it was a secret certainly to success. And I forget which one, Bobby Lennox, I don't know who it was, had said, I was up to match.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A couple of years ago, and one saying that, you know, when they won the European Cup, team were just amazed at their fitness.
Mm-hmm.
Because at that particular time there was one country in the world that was renowned for their fitness, and that was the Italians.
Right.
Because they used to take their players to these mountain retreats, and it was well documented that they used to lock them away there for a week before a game, and then
mm-hmm.
allow them out to play, and then lock them up again after the game, and that's the way they sort of lived in Italy. So they were renowned for the unbelievable fitness. And I think if you see any pictures of the Italian team in the Champions and European Cup final, you look at them, they're all trim and they're real athletes. But seemingly at the end of that game, they were saying how they couldn't believe the pace and stamina and that of the Celtic lads. And of course, when that happens with a bunch of players who, outside of Celtic, probably outside of Scotland, certainly weren't household names before the game, because they'd all come, Simpson had come from Newcastle, and, you know, the rest of them had come from near Glasgow, and Jock had got all these players together and made them into obviously a European Cup winning team.
Yeah.
Through that dedication, commitment, and that unbelievable level of fitness that I never, ever, never considered. England didn't exist. It didn't exist, and you know, it was only because you get in the Scotland team, and when you get in the Scotland team, you meet up with a load of players that are based in England, and you sit around most of the time, as you can imagine.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you're waiting for the Wednesday game to come or the Saturday game to come, and you're talking and you're chatting, and obviously it's only then do you find out that, in terms of payment, that, you know, you're not getting anywhere near what they're getting.
Mm-hmm.
And if your circumstances change in any way, then, you know, your payment's got to change. And you know, my circumstances did change. I got married and a kid on the way.
Yeah.
I'd lost my father as well. So when my first contract was up, I needed more money.
Mm-hmm.
Simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
And went in to see Jock, and it wasn't forthcoming. And I just said, right. Again, when you're young, you've no idea if anyone is going to be interested in you. You've no idea if anyone's going to take you.
Yeah.
I said, oh, well, I'm not staying then. I'm going somewhere else. Try and get some more money.
Mm-hmm.
Just looking for a job, as you would class it at the time, of getting a job that was better paid. And never did I think I'd even consider that.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, things change, and as I say, getting married changed things, having a child on the way changed things. And,
sure.
And losing my father changed things even more when I had to support my mother.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, you know, Davey will probably say that he probably never felt as if he'd ever leave Celtic and never wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be the way it was, because that, you know,
it's
your team.
It was Macari who got the first lucrative move of all the Quality Street gang when he joined Manchester United. By 1975, he was playing his football in English second division with the Red Devils, and he moved further back into midfield from the forward role where he had been so prolific in his youth. He left United in 1984, but not before 15,000 Celtic fans gave him a great reception at his Old Trafford testimonial. Macari moved on to Swindon, where he became player manager. He continued as a boss of several English sides before being surprisingly named as Celtic manager in 1993. This was during a turbulent era for everyone associated with the club, and his unorthodox signings and lack of success meant that his managerial tenure was a short one. Another youngster, Bobby Wraith, grew up near to Lou Macari and Largs, and was Celtic's first choice goalkeeper in Casale after signing on his 20th birthday on the 26th of April 1968.
Moggy, first of all, when you think back to signing for Celtic in 1968, can you tell us how that came about, how the interest developed, and then actually signing for the club?
Oh yes, I remember it quite well. Celtic had sent a wee reserve team down to Wraith, where I was playing junior football, in a benefit match for an older chap called Harry Patterson, and they sent a very strong team, and I played pretty well. So at the end of the game, I get invited into the other dressing room by Mr. Steen and Mr. Fallon, and asked to go for a trial the following night against Home Farm in Dublin. And I remember saying to him, I don't know if I can get off my work, Mr. Steen, but he just said, tell them where you're going, son, you got off your work, it's no problem. So the following night, which was my birthday, 26th of April 1968, you can't forget that, can you? It's 20. We played Home Farm in Dublin, and we won 7-2. Again, played quite well, and they asked me to sign straight away. And the obvious answer to that is I signed. And that was it, that's how that happened.
That's excellent, Bobby. So when you then went to Celtic, Joe Steen was gathering the best of Scottish talent at your age group. Could you think back to that and the types of players that you would be playing alongside?
Well, I can look back and think about the types of players I was playing alongside with the history that they've got now. I knew obviously they were good players, quality players, Lou Macari, Kennys, and different people. But I didn't know just how good they were, because I had only been playing junior football. But they were just tremendous players, and they grew in to be obviously tremendous players after that, and it was a pleasure to play with them.
One of the big things that a lot of your contemporaries talk about is the development on the training pitch, training with the Lisbon Lions, Bobby. If you can think back to that, any kind of memories of how they helped you along and how hard it was when you were actually training against them?
Well, it was hard training against them, because obviously they were quality players. But I used to try and play out sometimes when I was doing that. You play the first wee bit in goal, and then it would just come into a bit of a match, and never anything went. And I'd go and play left back against Jimmy Johnson. And it was just great. The banter was brilliant. There was no bad tackles, nothing, very, very competitive, but no bad tackles. And used to get a great laugh. And I just discovered Jimmy's wee trick. And I could watch and watch and watch. And he used to lift the ball over the guy's foot. Well, I would wait and see him beat two or three players, nip in and steal the ball, and used to lose the rag. But yeah, the training at Celtic was great. It was a fantastic time, really, really good.
You were telling me about a time when you're going into the changing room and Big Jock's having a bath, and he called you over. Can you remember that?
Aye. Anyway, I walked in the changing room after the training session, and the big man's in the bath. I went, "Hi, Bobby." I went, "Hi, boss." I think I asked him that day, did I call him Mr. Steen or boss? And he said it was boss. I said, "Aye." And he went, "And you didn't tell me you were a blue nose, did you?" I said, "Well, Mr. Steen, you didn't ask. So I didn't tell you," and I just walked through the changing room. That was it. Finished that. That was that wee story.
You mentioned a couple of the guys you played alongside. Did you think that that team that you were part of would develop and gradually replace the Lisbon Lions?
If Louie and Kenny and all them had stayed together, yes, they would have gone a long way too. I don't know if they would actually have replaced them. I don't know if they'd ever replace anything like that. But yeah, there were some fantastic players in it. Great quality, great quality.
Not too long after you signed, you and your teammates went away to get fitted up for a green blazer for a special trip to Italy. Can you remember back to getting that blazer, how that made you feel?
Aye. Me and Louis, I just can't remember I think it was the Ayrshire boys that went, maybe that's what it was, John Murray and them. And they went up, and you get fitted for this blazer, and you stood there giving it in the mirror. Oh, the wee badge and everything. And of course, with me being an ex-blooner, I'm thinking, what's all this about? But I've still got it in the house, it's still there. It doesn't fit me now right enough, but it was a fantastic feeling, it was excellent. And it was all done in a rush, because the trip was within a very, very short space of time after I signed. And there you go. So what was saying to you before, 1 minute you're playing for the Wraith Thistle, next minute you're playing in a European Cup in Italy with Celtic. So it was a fantastic time.
In that particular tournament, again, you went over there and you performed really well as a team. Can you remember anything about that trip and how the boys were getting a good experience of playing in Europe at a young age?
I can't really remember an awful lot about it. The only thing I remember is we played three games, lost one goal, and got knocked out. Juventus, I can't remember who, and the local team Casale, and somebody else I can't remember. But it was a big development. But it was just, it went over my head. It was too soon for me, if you know what I'm saying. Juventus, give us a break. You're not playing fools, are you? So, but I thoroughly enjoyed that as well, and it bonded the guys together. It was really, really good with that.
You then progressed into the first team and made a first team appearance on a memorable night against Hamilton, where Celtic won 4-2 in 1968, and yourself and a couple of other boys made their debuts that night. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about that night and your memories about that debut.
My memory is obviously that was my debut, as you say. The first team had won 10-0, and we were in, and you just went and played in it, and we beat them 4-2. And I can't really remember how the whole thing went, but I lost a bit of a soft goal, in as much as you come out, you see the chance in a big crowd of players, it come off the guy's foot onto, and I bang, and it just kind of bust me. But the actual game itself, I can't remember, but it's daft for your goalkeeper's point of view. You remember these wee things, you see it, you go for it, it takes a wee bit of a knock, and it's a goal. And they didn't like goals against at Celtic Park, by the way, that's another thing.
Another big thing about that night was the coming of age, I suppose,
it came about, and to be fair, my boy showed me that, told me that years after. I didn't realise, because we were all just a big group of lads, and the excitement of playing for the first team was in yourself, and you really weren't bothered who else was playing. I knew Lou would be playing and things like that, whatever, but it was, you were just kind of interested in yourself, and I didn't notice the other two or three lads that were making their debuts as well. As long as I was playing, I wasn't caring. So
68 was a big year for the Coalition gang, and Jockstein made a proposal to actually install you into the second division. Can you remember the thinking behind that, and how do you think you would have performed?
I think it would be a great thing at that particular time. I think it would be a great thing. It would certainly have brought you on, and whilst the reserve league was quite a strong league, the actual competitive league situation, you know, and maybe going up, I think would have been better for us. But it was only mentioned in passing, so to speak, and nothing, as you know, obviously came of it. But I think it would have been a good idea, and I think it would have developed you far better.
One of the big things that has been noted since Steve's time at Celtic is the amount of goalkeepers who went through Bobby. Being a goalkeeper yourself, can you maybe talk to us about your thinking behind his failure to coach goalkeepers at training and bring them through the ranks?
Mm-hmm. Well, basically speaking, coaching's the word for me. You trained and you trained and you trained and you ran and you ran and you ran, and you were just exercised, dive for this, jump for that, dive for, fit as a fiddle. But you went home the same goalkeeper as you went up to Celtic Park. Nobody took you to show you angles or show you how to come out for the cross or help you. And believe me, the difference between junior football and playing at Celtic Park was night and day, and a wee bit of assistance would have helped you. The secret is coaching, and I get none of it, and it really, really broke my heart. I did ask, but I only got a couple of tips. No coaching for day to day, training, as I say, fit as a fiddle, fit as a flea, as you say, but no coaching. And I think it was an error, and I would have loved to have been coached, but there we go.
Thanks very much for that. Now, your crop, possibly the last great crop to come through Celtic Park, had they stayed together, I know it's a difficult question, what do you think that team would have achieved?
How do you mean, just if you stayed together at Celtic Park, and just continued as a group? Oh, I think they've done very, very well. As long as I'd been in goal, I'd have been delighted. But yeah, they had too many quality players not to have done well. You know, the people I had playing in front of me, Danny McGrain, George Connolly, Davy Hay, and John Gorman, sometimes I was bored. Do you wonder why? So don't tell me, four internationalists in front of you, Lou Macari, Ken Delis in front of them. Ah, they would have done very, very well. And it was just a pleasure to play. Actually, the boys would talk you through. I'll be off. Steve, I'll be off. Gone. Gordy was great at it. John Gorman was great at that. He was away, and that was it. Oh, they would have done exceptionally well. So one of the stories I was desperate to tell you, Paul, was the first goal ever in at Celtic Park. And again, it's just a great memory for me, because, as I say, a week before I was playing at Dunfermline Athletic, and we're playing Dunfermline Athletic at Celtic Park, and everything's going fine. I'm feeling tremendous, we're doing okay, we're 1-0 up, and everything's hunky-dory. They've hit a bit of a speculative ball into the box. Davey saw it, and he shouted to me, "Bobby!" I said, "I've got it, Davey, just knock it back here." And he headed it back to me. At that, John Gorman, I could hear John, "Bobby!" And I looked to see John, and at the same time I went to catch the ball, and I went to throw it to John, but I forgot to keep a hold of it, and I dropped it, and it hit me in the shoulder, and went in the back of the net. Now, my two favourite players at Celtic Park were George Cronin and Davey, eventually, so they were my guardian, so to speak. And let me tell you, when I went into the bath that night, I thought I was going to get drowned, because you were playing for money then. It was a win bonus and a draw bonus, and I'd cost them a stupid goal. It was terrible. It just was embarrassing. So I jumped into the bath, and I thought, "Oh, here we go." And I felt a bit rattling the back of my nut, and it's Sean going, "Don't worry about it. It's okay." Because I'm near crying. I'm broken hearted. Another boy going, "Don't worry about it, Bobby. We're boring it. We'll go on and go on." And okay, we progressed a bit better. But that's my everlasting memory of my first game at Celtic Park.
Bobby Wraith was freed on the same day as his friend Pat McMahon on the 2nd of May 1969. He received no offers from senior clubs in Scotland, and David Katanak put him in touch with junior side Johnstonborough. Bobby played a trial and was offered a contract, but a couple of weeks later he received a telegram from Southport, and he ended up going down there and living for over 40 years. After 2 years playing with Southport, he was offered a trial with Exeter, Carlisle and Morton, but by that time Bobby had joined the police, and he is now a retired sergeant who has captained the British police in goals. Centre forward Hugh McKellar, who was known to his teammates as Aidan or Aidy, was one of four St Michael's boys, along with Jim Clark, John Murray and Lou Macari, to make the trip to Italy.
Hugh, first of all, when we go back to your early football career, one of the things that struck me when I was researching the book is that yourself, John Murray, Jim Clark and Lou Macari all went to the same school, playing the same team.
Uh-huh.
What's your early memories of that particular team and those individual players?
Well, I went to... When I was in primary school, I was in Androsson. John and Jim Clark were in Salkets, and there was great competition. So I knew them before I went to St Michael's and winning when we played in the same team. And we were great rivals at that time. I never actually met Lou Macari until we went on a summer camp thing to West Linton, and I met up with Lou at that time. And we were all in the West Linton team that played some local games. But Lou was a phenomenon, and I'd never seen anybody like Lou before. So, but the three of them were really good players. John, the funny thing about John Murray, John was a really big guy in first year. And there's a first year photograph where I'm a wee fat fella sitting in the outside right position. John is this giant in the middle of the photograph, and Lou's legs didn't even move sitting in the chair. His legs, his feet never even reached the floor. So it's a comical thing, but that's the way it was. But we were a good side, and we played together. We won the Under 15 Cup, Scottish Cup. We should have won the Under 18 one as well, but things didn't work out that way. But and we were great friends as well.
I'll speak about that because it must have been interesting when you all ended up. I know John went via Capello, but you all ended up at Celtic Park. Mm-hmm. Can you just tell us your memories of Celtic's approach, how that came about, how you ended up at Celtic Park itself?
Jim and Lou, they were picked up playing in a Scottish trial, and so they were away earlier. I stayed on to finish 6 years at school, and I also was playing with Ardy Rec. I went junior. And I played trials for several teams prior to. In fact, I played against Celtic. I was on trial for Aberdeen, and I played against Davy Hay, and it was one of the sorest evenings I've had. I also played against George Cornley later. But anyway, I was approached and asked to play a trial for Celtic, and I remember the trial. It was against Falkirk at Brockville, and. We won 2-0 that night. I managed to score a goal, and Steen asked me if I would sign, which I was more than happy to do. It was The teams from down south, for example, Everton offered a really good deal and were happy to continue my education, which Jockstein wasn't that keen on you, not the part-time situation, but I was an Ayrshire lad, I'd been out of Ayrshire very much at that point, and the idea of going to Liverpool maybe frightened me a bit, but I was more than happy to end up at Parkhead.
Absolutely, and when you came up to Celtic Park and you look around at the other boys, your contemporaries, your peers, if you like, what can you remember of the boys that Celtic had up there? Who stood out for you?
The player that I would have loved to have been was Paul Wilson. Paul Wilson was the first person that I'd come across who could bend the ball and did step overs and everything, and he was phenomenally fast. At that time, if you'd asked me who was going to be the star, it would have been Paul Wilson. I know Big George had all the skills and all the rest of it, but now Paul, I think his speed and his ball control was marvellous. I thought he was a great player, and he was younger than me. He was, I think both him, Kenny and Danny, they were a year younger than me.
It's interesting that all these boys came together at a specific time, Hugh, and there was an organised youth tournament that was dubbed the Junior European Cup. Uh-huh. A lot of players speak about their going to get fitted up for their suit and uh-huh. the press coming. But what was your memories of the build-up to that tournament?
I was injured just before that and I was concerned about whether we'd actually get going or not. But there was a tremendous excitement, as I said. I'd had a minute of aversion in my mind going to play football in Italy. So there was a tremendous excitement. I'm not exactly sure when we were told who would be going or whatever, but there was a great camaraderie between all the lads at that time. And I'm glad that everybody associated with that group of players, that we all ended up going, because it was great fun. When I look back on my time at Parkhead, it's the fun that I had there that I remember most. Like every footballer, you look back, particularly footballers who never made it, there were the regrets, the frustrations, the despair. But that's all forgotten, and the thing that I remember most about it was the amount of fun and the nice people that I met.
Absolutely, and again, you mentioned there it's a big gap at that age, but some of the boys were a wee bit younger, like Vic Davidson, mm-hmm. Danny and Kenny, etc. And there's a fantastic picture of yourself with John Gorman, so, you know, people like John, David Hay, George Conley, when you were playing alongside them, did you see their real quality even at such a young stage?
Yes, I had all of the players that were there. They were all good players. I can't. Very often, if you play for a team, there's somebody that was a bit dodgy. But all of the players that were there, they were superb players, and it was difficult to get a place in that team. And seeing himself experimented a lot with moving players around different positions and all the rest of it. So, but it was difficult, and you also had. Players from the first team coming back in to get themselves fit again. They were playing reserve, so you had that problem as well. Particularly Joe McBride, because Joe McBride was the recognised striker, and he had the bad knee injury. But they kept, so a lot of the time Joe would be holding down that centre forward spot, which was the one I was looking for. I thought all of them were great players, and as I said, I played against Davy Hay, and I wouldn't like to do it very often.
You mentioned Joe McBride there, and often if a player was coming back from injury, a loss of form, they would come and play alongside mm-hmm. you in the reserve uh-huh. team. What's your memories of the Lisbon, the senior players, and uh-huh. how they helped the youngsters to progress and develop?
Well, just to mention Joe McBride, for example, we used to have a meal in the Vesuvius after training, or after games anyway, on a Saturday, which was just off George Street. And I remember one night Joe being in there and sitting chatting to me. It was early after I'd signed, after the pre-season, and he had said to me that he was really impressed by how fast I had got over that period in time, and he encouraged me to go and do extra work and work with spikes and all the rest of it. So there was always a closeness between us, because we trained together every day. There was There wasn't anyone in the first team who looked down on you or made you feel uncomfortable. They were all very helpful. Obviously, with personalities, you like one person more than the other, but I had great respect for all of them. But I particularly liked Jim Craig, and Billy McNeil was always very, very supportive. I travelled up in the car with Bobby Lennox and Jimmy Johnston and Willie and Neil were great pals, and they were great fun together. So the fact that Bobby was taking us up in the car, that there was already a link made there. But Ronnie Simpson was an older man. They all seemed older, although they were only in their mid-20s, but it seemed like they meant to be anyway, though. But maybe Kenny Dougherty's behind me thought I was an old man as well. I'm not sure, but Stevie Chalmers and Ronnie Simpson, I would say, were perhaps, I looked upon them as kind of older men, but they were really nice. They were both gentlemen.
It sounds as though the spirit within that side was something special. Jock was quite clear with the boss, but what roles did the other backroom staff play in terms of the reserve team and how yous developed?
Well, Neely Malkin was very important. He was part of the training all the time, and although Jock was pulling his strings, Neely less so Sean Fallon, but Neely was always out there playing. I think mainly because he liked playing to still have a kick at the ball, so. I was always very impressed with Neely, and I'm not sure who actually chose the reserve team. I'm not sure whether it was Fallon that chose it or whether it was Steen or further between them. I've no idea how that came about, but everyone was the only complaint I would ever have had against Parkhead that I had a bad ankle injury, and it's been with me my whole life, and I don't really feel it was dealt with properly. But to be fair to the people, I wouldn't like to name anybody, but to be fair to the people, they didn't have the technology then that they have now. I also had a bad back injury which was causing terrible pains in the legs, and again, when I was kind of poo-pooed at the idea, because that was still the age of the wet sponge that cured everything, which in this particular case with my back it didn't cure, but that's it. But I was never aware of acrimony anywhere in the stadium at that particular point in time.
We were up yesterday up at Barrowfield doing a bit of work there. Right. What's your memories, not only of the training side of things, but these bounce games that used to be played between the first and the second teams?
Well, I can remember lots of stories. It was good fun. Again, I said of the times, we walked from Parkhead to, rain, hail or snow, you walked up there. And amazingly, no one ever bothered you, everyone just accepted it up and went there. There was usually quite a crowd watching these bounce games. There's two things I can remember in particular about the games. One was there was a kind of sheltered area halfway along the park, and we were playing against, it was always the reserves against, I thought it was 15 a side sort of football, but I remember Tommy Gemmell having his back to me, but he was facing this crowd, and he was preventing me getting at the ball. But he was obviously making faces and taking the mickey out of me, which eventually, when they all started laughing, I lost. So I stepped back and gave Tommy a whack, which he wasn't too pleased about. And after the training, Jock's team was getting into his cars, I was getting into mine, and he says, "You're some man, kicking my players." And the other thing I remember about a game there was that we got a penalty, and I was always very good at taking penalties. And it was Ronnie Simpson that was goal. And when I took the penalty, I put it into Ronnie's right hand post, and when I looked up, he was standing there waiting on it. No, so it completely read what I was going to do. But he was a star in goals, despite being a small man. But they were always competitive games. I had a couple of run-ins with Bertel, but less said about that, the better.
You were one of the fortunate people within that team to actually make the step up to the first team yourself. Hugh, if you think back to the lead-up, finding out about the fact that you were in the first team squad, being in the change room and actually going out there and playing for the first team, what's your memories of that?
Well, I didn't know until just prior to the game, so but the very fact that Pat and Mac and I were chosen to be in the squad for that particular night was fantastic. I was so excited before it. The thing I'll remember, you'll maybe find this strange, the thing I remember about it, being out in the park for the warm-up before we started, obviously it was the biggest crowd that I'd ever been before, and I was constantly aware of flashing lights, which eventually I realised it was people lighting up to smoke. And it was amazing from the park, the amount of lighting we were on. Seems a strange thing to think about, though, just before you're about to play. But and the buzz, it was just great. When I eventually got on, to be honest, in part, unfortunately, I replaced Jimmy Johnston, and not because it was a bad game. I think just what he'd been. But anyway, I would have liked to have him to be in the park at the same time as well. But anyway, I was playing with great players, and it's a memory that I'll never forget. I played again up at Inverness as well. When I look back on, obviously you're disappointed that you don't make it, but I've never had any. Never any feelings of bitterness or anything about it. It was a wonderful part of my life, and I look back on it with happiness.
Fantastic. One of the stories you told me, and you had good memories of this as well, was when you were actually playing up here in a bounce game, a practice match, uh-huh, against the Scottish international team.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And you had good, vivid memories of that. Could you describe what you remember about the game up here?
Well, first of all, I remember the very fact that we were playing against Scotland and players that I'd only ever seen on television and such, like, because there was a lot of them coming up from the south, and Alec Nozine, who'd been my hero, was playing that night as well. So we were shipped over here. I remember being in the Hampden dressing rooms, and it was so plush compared to Parkhead. Parkhead was a bit barren at the time. I remember Brown coming in and explaining to us that we'd be playing soon and no dirty tackles and all that sort of thing. I don't think he told the same thing to his own team, but anyway, that's either here or there. So I do remember that, and then coming out onto the park. After that, it was just like any other game. We beat them 5-2. I was playing against Ewer and McKinnon that night, and I managed to get a couple. And I would have scored more if it hadn't been for Ronnie Simpson, who was in goals, because I had a couple of one-on-ones with him, but as usually outfoxed me, so that was it. And also remember great displays by Macari, Conley, Hay. I can't remember whether Danny was playing that night or not. I'm not sure, but I remember the three of them being outstanding.
I mean, that seems like a real test, obviously, for the young boys, and they came through it. Uh-huh. Jockstein was keen to test you further and actually made an application to put the reserve team into the second division at that
yes,
time.
Yes, I played a lot of friendlies with second division teams. We also went down, I remember going down to Rotherham when Tommy Doherty was the manager at that time, and we went down there and beat them 3-1 as well. The whole economics and whether it was a right thing or a wrong thing wasn't really our remit, and if Steve wanted to do that, it was fine, and just let it go in. But we were more than keen to play in those games. But even at that time, all the other Scottish Division teams had good reserve teams. Now, when Celtic reserves played against them, none were easy games. And certainly, I played 3 times against Rangers reserves, and there was always a big crowd for that as well, and they were hard games. Fortunately, I never lost in any of them, so that was a pleasing part as well. But because when I was in at Ardeer Rec, my friend Cammy Evans, he came for a trial that same night that I played in Falkirk, but he was of the other persuasion and decided to go to Rangers instead, although he was offered a contract at Parkhead.
You've spoken about Lou Macari briefly. Uh-huh. It must have been a difficult task for any young striker to make it in that first team at Celtic. Uh-huh. But when you look to your left and right, you've got players like Dalglish, Macari and Davidson.
Uh-huh.
How did that help you as a player with a competitive edge? And what can you remember about the younger strikers like Vic and Kenny Dalglish?
Well, when I was there, Kenny wasn't played as a striker. The feeling at that time was Jock Stein saw him as the next Bobby Murdoch, although I never actually saw a similarity in style. And the same, Vic didn't play a lot, and being younger, he wasn't really in the team when I was there. I could recognise them as good players, and obviously I mentioned Paul Wilson earlier. And of all the players, of the young players, Paul Wilson was the one that I thought would have made it. But Kenny, I didn't know Kenny really all that, because he's very quiet. So was Danny McGrain, was very quiet. And Paul too. Paul was a shy lad as well. The year above, we were a year older, and we were quite a boisterous. We weren't bad lads, but we were up for a laugh, and it was difficult for the younger lads, you know, just to kind of break into that sort of thing. So they tended to be a lot quieter, but they were undoubtedly superb players.
And one of the biggest stars of that team happened to be Lou Macari eventually.
Uh-huh.
You seen the early promise of Lou, but some of the players spoke about a dogged determination to get stronger and get fitter and get faster. Did you see Lou working at his game and improving whilst you were at Celtic Park?
Not any more than anyone else, but because the whole idea of like weight training and such like wasn't in vogue at that particular point in time. But he was a determined lad, and being smaller sometimes makes you, you know, try harder, you know, to be more physical. But he was a great trainer, Lou, and he worked very hard, and he was ambitious. He believed in his own ability, and quite rightly so, and it would pay dividends for him in the long run. Unfortunately, I've never actually seen Lou since I left Parkhead, which is a bit unfortunate, but that's the way life is.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. I mean, two of the players who went over to Italy with you, within 2 years were playing in the European Cup final, albeit George came on as a sub.
Right.
In your mind, when you look at David Hay and George Conway, two of the brightest prospects at Celtic Park in Scottish football, uh-huh, how highly did you rate them, Hugh? Did you know they were going to go on and play at World Cups and European Cup finals?
I'm not sure about World Cups. That's a difficult one to determine, but it was obvious that they were going to make the grade. I never had any doubt. Amazingly enough, perhaps had a slight doubt about George, because George lacked pace, but I never had any doubt at all about Davy Hay. It was possibly the hardest player I've ever played against, and also played against Danny McGrain, and Danny was a tenacious player as well. George, I played against George when I was playing with Kilmarnock. I played against George, and I'd rather play against George than play against Davy. But it was a class player. One of the things that may have affected George, I don't know, I'm only speculating, was the fact that he didn't really want to play centre half. He wanted to play midfield, because I remember before we went to Italy, the night that we played Dorai, and when I first came across Bobby Wraith, Steen played me centre half and pushed George further forward, but by the time we got to Italy, it had been changed round again, and George was playing centre half. So whether that affected his attitude to the fact that he wasn't getting what he wanted, I don't know. I've never spoke to George since then either. George was a very quiet lad. I never really had a lot of conversation with him, I didn't like him or anything. He just was very quiet and unlike some of the others.
I think the development of that team continued into the 70s, of course, and you know, Kenny Dalglish and Danny Green started to come through. Mm. There was about half a dozen in the nucleus of that team, about half a dozen in the first team.
Uh-huh.
But unlike the Lisbon Lions that came before Hugh, Celtic started selling some of these players on, and we didn't really see them all hit their peak at the same time.
Mm.
What do you think, as a team, they may have achieved had they stayed together for a few more years?
Well, I felt that was a mistake. I felt that Steen started to tinker with the team immediately after. For example, Bobby Lennox wasn't playing as regularly as he should have been, and Jim Brogan was coming in for John Clark. Now, I'm not saying that the people that Jim Brogan was a good player as well, but maybe he didn't quite dovetail with Billy McNeil as well as John Clark had done. Steen also, the very fact that Jim Craig was a dentist and could decide whether he was going to go to see Mill or not, didn't particularly please Steen, so he started to thinking about with that position as well. I think he should have let it be for a bit longer. I could see, and even more now, I could see what he was trying to do. This whole idea of a libero and moving away from static positions and such like. I just think he was doing it too early, and he was trying to make the players play a role rather than having the players that were suited to that role. But that's all my personal opinion, and it's can't very well sit here and say that I'm no better than Jock Steen, kind of.
Finally, Hugh, when the time finally came for you to actually meet Celtic, could you tell us your memories about that? And now, all these years later, how fondly do you look back on the period of time that you had up at Parkhead?
The reason I left was there was two reasons. Firstly, I wanted to go and be a teacher. I found professional football a bit boring because we trained, that time we trained from say 10 to 1, and then the rest of the day was left to yourself. When I signed it first, it was still the summer and I was going back down to Ayrshire, and all my mates were there and they were playing tennis. And everything was fine, but when it came to the winter, it was a long time. So I then started to study music again, and I went for piano lessons to a wonderful woman called Roy up in Charing Cross. Because when the first team, particularly the first team, found out about me going for piano lessons, I took a bit of stick, particularly from Tommy Gemmell, but I never let it deter me. So I had that in mind, that I didn't actually have in mind to go and be a music teacher, but I wanted to go to PE college. So that was the first thing. And the second thing, I realised that I wasn't going to make it at Parkhead, so it was time to move on. It was a sad day when they handed me my boots and I walked out the door, but I never really looked back on it with it, as I say, with any bitterness whatsoever. It was a wonderful 2 years of my life. I met such wonderful people. I'm only sorry that because of the way life worked out, I drifted away and I didn't actually see a lot of them. I didn't see that. I met Danny McGrain when I was doing the SFA coaching, and I've bumped into David Hay a couple of times. I see Jim Clark, John Murray, but the others went on their own way as well. But I don't feel bad about it, because there were better players than me, never made it at Parkhead, and I was also there at a time when possibly the best players that they ever had were there, so it wasn't easy. But very fond memories of the club and the people that I met at the club.
Hugh McKellar left Celtic in 1969, where he would be joined again with his ex-St Michael's schoolmate, Jim Clark, at Kilmarnock. Within 6 months, his back complaint resurfaced, and it would eventually end his career prematurely. He was forced to give up the game and went on to become a principal teacher of music at St Joseph's College in Dumfries. Hugh McKellar attended the book launch of the Quality Street Gang, as did Paul Wilson, and he was one player that can rightfully take his place in the Quality Street elite. With a Celtic career spanning over 10 years, a full Scottish international cap, participation in 6 league winning campaigns, 1 League Cup and 2 Scottish Cup winners medals, Paul Wilson suffered the loss of both his parents and faced torrid racial abuse during a Celtic career that should never be underestimated. Unlike many of his contemporaries, Jock Steen never moved Wilson on, and he eventually left the club when new boss Billy McNeil made it clear that he wasn't part of his plans in 1978. He went on to have brief spells with Motherwell and Partick Thistle, but by then his troublesome ankle wasn't up to the rigours of full-time football, and he retired before he was even 30. I'll finish this podcast with a song, which has a tenuous link to the origins of the named Quality Street Gang. I will explain this in more detail in part two, but until then, here are Thin Lizzy with The Boys Are Back in Town.
Change had much to say, but man, I still think them cats are crazy. They were asking if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. I told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy.
The boys are back in town. The boys are back in town.
I said,
the boys are back in town.
Chick that used to dance a lot. Every night she'd be on the floor shaking what she'd got. Man, when I tell you she was cool, she was red hot. I mean she was steaming. And that time over at Johnny's place, well, this chick got up and she slapped Johnny's face. Man, we just fell about the place. If that chick don't wanna know, forget her.
The boys are back in town. The boys are back in town.
I said,
the boys are back in town.
Summer comes, now that the boys are here again.